meeting Earthlings, if you follow the channel, you know that we love all things Apollo. And that during our last visit to Steve Jurvetson's amazing space collection, we were given the opportunity to take two holy boxes of Apollo electronics to our lab for a deeper look. These are from the command module. We believe these are the S-band transponder and power amplifier. Oh boy, oh boy! These are the boxes that brought you voice, data and live TV from the moon and should be early masterpieces of microwave electronics, the blackest of black arts in analog electronics. Among the many technical advances which are the legacy of the Apollo program, three stand out that have influenced technology until today. The first one is the most obvious, the colossal space rocketry, which considerably expanded the US space industry and led to the shuttle program. The second one is arguably the Apollo guidance computer, which took the bold decision to use the first integrated circuits just a few weeks after the first 30 pre-production samples became available. This probably had the largest economic impact, jump-starting the US microelectronics industry and the rise of Silicon Valley, which legacy has carried on until today. But today we'll take a look at a third and less obvious one, microwave telecommunications. The Apollo program stretched the limits of what was then thought possible, achieving live TV transmission at lunar distances, in black and white at first, then even in color. This was done over the Unified S-band link, as it was called. This single 2 GHz link carried voice and an array of data formats in both directions, as well as live television, while at the same time measuring position and speed of the spacecraft to an astounding degree of precision. How was this possibly done with 1960s technology? Well, we're about to find out as we're planning on opening up these boxes and have a look-see inside. And you know us, power them up again if we can. Unfortunately, my modern camera electronics do not have a space level of reliability, and due to an unfortunate malfunction, I lost all the sound from the footage I took while Mike Stewart, Master Ken and I were opening them for the first time. So you'll have to endure my French-accented voiceover on a background of soothing game music. So here Ken is obviously demonstrating how heavy these things are. These boxes are way heavier than you'd expect for space hardware, but that's about the lightest they could make them. For fun, we put them on the scale. The amplifier was 15 kilograms, or about 33 pounds, and the transponder did not fare much better at 14 kilograms, or about 30 British archaic weight units. And that's not because of the beefy shells, as they were made of surprisingly light and thin magnesium. It's just the weight of the electronics inside. But before we look at these heavy boxes in more detail, let me explain how the unified S-band bidirectional link worked. At its core, the USB link, as it was called, is primarily a ranging system. NASA JPL had previously developed it for its early solar system exploration probes. The Ranger probes in 1961, the Mariner probes to Venus in 1962, and to Mars in 1964. Let's say that we have a good-looking spacecraft really far away, and we want to find out exactly how far it is and how fast it travels. For that, we use a giant antenna, 26 meters in diameter, which is 82 feet in archaic measurement units. No matter what your favorite measurement system is, it is a big antenna. They even had a 210-foot antenna at Goldstone in California, and another one at Parkes in Australia, that's a whopping 64 meters. Both were considered backup, but came in handy on the Apollo 11 landing when communication difficulties arose. We first sent a microwave carrier at exactly 2.1064.0625 GHz, as derived from an atomic clock. We'll call this reference frequency F0. This carrier signal is phase modulated by a pseudo-random code called a ranging code, which we'll have to explain later. This signal is received at the CSM by the transponder box. Because the spaceship is traveling at such high speed, and also because the ground station is rotating on Earth, the frequency it sees is not F0. It has been shifted a little bit by the Doppler effect. The shift is on the order of a few tens of kilohertz, which is small compared to the 2 GHz carrier frequency, but still fairly easy to measure. In any case, our receiver locks on and tracks this received frequency very exactly using a phase-locked loop, a clever circuit which I have explained in another video. It then translates this frequency by the ratio of 240 over 221 using frequency synthesis techniques, which I have also explained in the same video. The new frequency at around 2.2875 GHz, give or take the Doppler shift, is amplified using our amplifier box and sent back to Earth. At the same time, the receiver demodulates the ranging code from the incoming uplink, and the transmitter remodulates it on the downlink. It does what is called a data turnaround. The box that does this combination of receiving, frequency shifting, and retransmitting the same data it received is called a transponder, hence the name of our Holy Apollo box. Think of it as an assisted radar technique, where the target helps in reflecting the interrogating signal. The ground now receives the shifted signal and locks onto it. Note that once again, the signal has been shifted by Doppler, so the signal it gets has what is called a two-way Doppler shift, which frequency is indicated in the formula. The Earth station has now everything it needs to track the spacecraft. It gets the distance by figuring out the time delay in the pseudo-random ranging code. It gets the radial speed by measuring the two-way Doppler shift. And it gets the position by the antenna pointing. This ranging system is truly the backbone of the whole thing. Once two-way locking is accomplished, and you'll hear it being called out on the voice loops, voice and data is added on subcarriers in both directions, also using complicated method that we'll have to get into later. But that's not all. A third signal is transmitted down at yet another frequency on 2.2725 GHz. This carrier uses the more traditional FM modulation technique and transmits the famous TV signal, as well as recorded data and voice from the command module, and also recorded data and voice relayed from the LEM. It is used to retransmit the data that was gathered while the spacecrafts were not in contact with Earth, when they were behind the moon, for example, or if the LEM could not contact the Earth directly. Now, if this is not complicated enough, multiply this by 3, as there was another S-band link for the LEM, and another one for the rocket, operating on their own set of frequencies. All three could be operated at the same time. No wonder it took a full control center to manage all that. If there is just one thing to remember from this long explanation, it's that there are three frequencies involved and two carrier modulation techniques. A PM uplink at 2.1064 GHz, a PM downlink at 2.2875 GHz, and an FM downlink at 2.2725 GHz. These will be coming up all the time when we look at the detail of these boxes, and God forbid, try to make them work again. But for now, let's open up these bad boys. There are many screws involved. The reason is that the two boxes are hermetic. They were filled with dry nitrogen gas, and each box had a filled nipple. So here is the one for the transponder, and there is another corresponding one on the amplifier right here. And we were quite pleased to hear the hiss of the nitrogen getting out when we depressurized both of them. The protective nitrogen had stayed in there to this day, and the chances that the electronics will be in pristine condition were very high. Both of our units were conspicuously adorned with the Not For Flight stickers, but these were definitely the real NASA stuff used until 1976. The amplifier had the early serial number of 6, so these were likely early units used for qualification and then kept on the ground for further testing and experimentation. Master Ken, working on the amplifier, was the first one to cross the finish line, as, believe it or not, he had less screws than Mike. So here's a big reveal. Ooh, voila! And here's the full amplifier. Big transformer, danger, high voltage. Don't stick your fingers in there. A whole maze of coaxes. And the connectors to the antenna and the transponder. And there's one that's connected to nothing, but actually that's normal. And first we suspected the traveling wave tubes, which are the core amplifying element in the amplifier, was hidden in this danger high voltage thing and powered by the big transformer. But as you'll see, it turned out to be quite different. It was then Mike's turn for the big transponder reveal. Serious microwave electronic goodness in there. The mini RF coax connections between the different modules are immediately apparent. But you can also spot immediately that the transponder is redundant. There is two of most everything, although not all. The amplifier is redundant too, we'll get to it, but it was less obvious when looking at it for the first time. The complexity of the wiring is a little bit overwhelming at first, but we eventually figured out pretty much what goes on every one of those coax cables. But for now, let's admire this. This is made by Motorola, the transponder that is. The other box, the amplifier, is made by Collins of today Rockwell Collins. Before we dive into more explanations about what we see, let's give a break to our neurons and just admire this hardware. Here's the Collins amplifier. Collins was the prime contractor for the Apollo communication system. And here is the Motorola transponder. So unfortunately, I lost the sound of the footage that we took when we actually opened these boxes live. But what are those, Mike? What are we looking at?
So first on the table closest to me is the S-band transponder from an Apollo Block 2 command module. And then on the table right behind that is the S-band power amplifier.
This is the main radio, right, mm-hmm. That did all the communications from the moon back to Earth.
Yep.
So this is the transponder, means transmitter receiver. Mm-hmm. Because it's a weird animal. In order to gain propagation distance, when they do ranging, they send the signal, it gets received, it gets shifted in frequency and gets retransmitted.
Right.
And you gain an enormous amount of dBs when you do that rather than simple reflection. And the box behind it is just a power amplifier. So it just works in transmit and raises to the power to the incredible level of 2.8 watts in low power mode. And when we say 11 point something?
Yeah, 11.6 watts minimum.
11.6 watts at full power. So they just use 11.6 watts to retransmit TV from the moon, which blows my mind, right? And of course, the reason they do that, first is that the amplifier back there is a tube-based animal, right? There was no solid-state device that could amplify microwave. This is in the microwave band at 2 gigahertz, and there was just nothing available but tubes. Mm-hmm. And then it gets heavy, I think, and they just stopped when it was too heavy.
Right, yeah, both of these boxes are right around 32 pounds, I think.
Yeah, we weigh them, right. I mean, when you weigh them, you don't expect them to be that heavy.
Right, yeah.
They feel super heavy. Yeah, so they beat it by putting an absolutely giant antenna on the ground and also blasting it with power going up.
So those two are linked by this cables. There's three cables. I can't remember. There's one that's the TV, and the two other must be the phase modulation or whatever. I have to look it up. Actually, it's over here. They have. Oh no, one is PM at this frequency, 2.28 gigahertz. One is FM, that's only the TV. So the main mode is phase modulated with all the data and voice, and the TV is just, I would say it's not an afterthought, but it's not redundant as the main mode. So we have the PM, that's J3, right? So that's the main output of the radio towards the amplifier. Then J2, that's when they do the TV and FM, goes over here, transmitted on a different frequency.
And J4 is...
And that's the receive. Then, okay, so that goes receive over here. Because also the receive frequency is not amplified at all by this box, it goes through the triplexer. So there's an output for the antenna that must be J5. And the antenna goes in the triplexer, which is this big box. It says danger high voltage, and that threw us off because we thought there was high voltage in the box, but there's not.
Right.
This is just a frequency filters, and just based on frequency, it kicks off the receive signal straight to the receiver. And it gets powered by the output of the traveling wave tubes, which are the amplifier, and goes back to the antenna in the other direction. So if you see it in the diagram, here are the antennas in the aircraft. It comes here, so this is bidirectional. The triplexer will kick the receive frequency this way, and it will ingest the FM and the PM frequency that way, and it's all combined using because they are all at different frequencies. So this, the receive is not done at the same frequency as the transmit, right?
Right.
So they don't interfere with each other. On the receiver, same thing, you have a combination of redundant mains, and you have a single FM. And this is actually the transmitter and the receiver. So the receives comes, this is receive, starts here. I disconnected it because I wanted to find out what kind of connector this was. Fortunately, this is an SMA, so we're going to be able to work with it. Then it goes into two identical receivers. And then on the transmitter, you have a redundant PM section, so this is the same. I think the transmitter is just this and this. And then you have a single FM section, which is the FM exciter and the FM power amplifier, which only puts out 100 milliwatts. So in case, if something goes wrong with the FM, that's it. You can't reuse it. If something goes wrong with the PM, you can switch to the other bank. And then if all else fails, there's a Morse key. on the front panel. No, that's not on the front panel. That's on. It's on a push to talk.
Yep.
They can transmit Morse.
All right, I think this is heavy enough for a first episode. The Apollo communications system is such a complicated thing. It's going to take us a while to explain all of that. We'll go into the details of each of these boxes, explain the rat's nest of coax cables in the amplifier, reverse engineer the transponder, and try to make everything work again over the next episodes. See you then!